Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Aranya Bhattacharjee from the School of Physical Sciences, Jawaharlal Nehru University. Today we are going to talk on module Local Magnetic Moment, Kondo Effect and Heavy Fermion System under the paper Solid State Physics. After completing this module, the students will be able to learn the origin of strong electron correlations, learn about the local magnetic moments, learn how local magnetic moment is responsible for the Kondo effect, learn the properties of heavy fermion systems. In strongly correlated electron systems, the electron interaction energies dominate the electron kinetic energies. Some important examples of strongly correlated systems are cuprate superconductors, heavy electron compounds like rare earth, quasi-particles with mass in excess of 1000 bare electron masses, fractional quantum Hall systems, quantum dots, which are tiny pools of electrons in semiconductors that act as artificial atoms. The origin of strong correlation is the local magnetic moment. We will be discussing about the local magnetic moments now. Now you see that particularly, you know, localized moments in alloys. So we start with that. There are problems in treating magnetism in conductors from purely a itinerant point of view. But on the other hand, in metals for which the magnetic ions have a partially filled D shell in the free atom, one's natural inclination might be to go to the other extreme, treating the d electrons with the same techniques used in a magnetic insulator, for example with the concept of direct exchange, but also supplemented by the indirect exchange that can also arise in metals. This also approach has also some, you know, like some problems. An ion that is in isolation has a magnetic electronic shell and may retain only fraction of its magnetic moment or none at all when placed in a metallic environment. So and this is very well known by the properties of this dilute magnetic alloys. So when, you know, like when small amounts of transition metal elements are dissolved in non-magnetic, often free electron like metals, the resulting alloy may or may not display a localized moment. And remember that the moment of the free ion is determined by the Hund's rule, which we had already discussed in some modules back. And this Hund's rule, which in turn are actually based on the consideration of the inter-ionic Coulomb interactions, and of course to the lesser degree on the spin orbit. A theory has to be developed. I mean, the theory of localized moments in dilute magnetic alloy must determine how these considerations are modified when the ion is not free but embedded in a metal. So that is, you know, like a very important concept that we have to, you know, sort of look into. Now, even if we were to ignore all interactions between the electrons on the magnetic ion and the electron and ions of the host metal, there would still be a simple mechanism by which the net moment of the ion could be altered. Now, depending on the position of the level of the ion relative to the metallic Fermi level, electrons might leave the ion for the conduction band of the host or drop from the conduction band into the lower lying ionic levels, thereby altering or in some cases even eliminating the moment of the ion. Now, in addition to this, because levels of the ions are degenerate with the continuum of conduction band levels in the host, there will be a mixing of levels in which the ionic ones become spatially less localized, while nearby conduction electrons levels have their charge distribution altered in the neighborhood of the magnetic ion. So this in turn will radically alter the intra-ionic energetics that determine the net spin configuration of those electrons that are localized near the ion. For example, as the ionic level becomes less and less localized, the intra-ionic Coulomb repulsion will become of progressively less importance. In short, the problem is one of considerable complexity, very complex indeed. And some insight has been provided by a model due to P.W. Anderson, which of course, you know, we will briefly discuss in couple of next slides, in which all the levels of the magnetic ions are replaced by a single localized level. Since the ions are treated in the Hubbard model and the coupling between the localized and the band levels is reduced to a bare minimum, if a measure of the complexity of problems in which both localized and band feature plays an important role, that even the highly oversimplified Anderson model has failed to yield an exact solution, in spite of its having been subject to an onslaught of theoretical analysis. So formally, you know, like, you know, when we can say that, you know, when electrons localize, they can form objects whose low energy excitations involve spin degrees of moment. In the simplest case, such localized magnetic moments are represented by a single neutral spin operator as shown in this equation, that is, the vector S is equal to H cross divided by 2 multiplied by the vector sigma. The sigma vector is a Pauli matrix of the localized electron. I'm sure that you must have learned about what exactly is a Pauli matrix in quantum mechanics. The localized magnetic moments develop within the highly localized atomic wave functions. You will see that in one of the figures, the most highly localized wave functions, they occur in the partially filled 4F shell of rare earth compounds, an example being cerium yttrium. Now, this is a very interesting picture. The schematic figure here shows here, where you go from bottom to the top, the increasing localization effect. Okay, and on the right hand side, these red spheres that you see, the three red spheres, indicates on the bottom about the transition metal, atom, the actinide, and on the top is the rare earth. Now, if you carefully look at the wave functions which are depicted on these red spheres, you will find that in the transition metal, the wave functions are slightly delocalized, they are spread out. Okay, slowly if you move up and you go to the actinide, you will see that slightly they are getting localized, that is, now that the wave function that you had in the transition metal, now it is spreading less. And on the rare earth, you will see that the highly localized, you know, the spreading is almost not there. So this is basically saying that the rare earth has the maximum localizing effect, that is, the wave function is highly localized in the case of rare earth. Collaborators showed that in small concentration of magnetic ions, which are represented as Ni, such as iron, are added to a metallic host. This metallic host could be, say for example, gold. They develop a Curie component to the magnetic susceptibility, indicating the formation of a local moment. The susceptibility is equal to Ni, the concentration of the magnetic ions, into the magnetization square divided by 3T, where T is the temperature. And the square of the magnetization M square is equal to G, J square nu, B square J into J plus 1, where this B is the magnetic field. And I am sure that you are familiar with what exactly is J, nu and G. So discussing about, you know, this local magnetic moments, as we have already, you know, said that P.W. Anderson was the first who sort of carried out a pioneering work in this direction, and his work gave a new insight into this local magnetic moments. So Anderson, you know, like, was the first to identify interactions between localized electrons as the driving force for local moment formation. Now, at this particular point, let me just tell you, like in, had we has mentioned before, like in rare earth element, the localization of the electrons is maximum. So from there, we can naturally, come to the conclusion that if we have very localized electrons, then naturally we should have also a very high degree of local moment formation. Now we consider an isolated atom with a localized spin s equal to half atomic state, which we shall refer to as a localized d state. In isolation, the atomic bound state is stable, and the Hamiltonian of the total system can be written as a sum of four terms. The four terms, as you can see, is HC plus H mix plus HD plus HU, and we will describe each of these terms slowly. So first, actually, we start with this term HD. Here, as you can see, that this HD is equal to ED summation over this spin state sigma over the occupation number, the operator N, which depends upon the D and sigma. Now, this particular term HD describes an isolated atomic d state of energy. Okay, d state of energy ED, and occupancy N d sigma in the up and down state. So either in up, either in down, like so this sigma can take up or sigma can stay down. And the term HU is equal to U multiplied by the occupancy operator N d up into the occupancy operator N d down. So that is basically this N d up basically means that N, the occupancy of the d state with the up spin, and N d down basically means this down arrow is the occupancy of the d state with down spin in the interatomic interactions between the up spin and the down spin d electron. Now, the term in the total Hamiltonian HC is written like this, that this is a summation over two parameters. One, of course, is sigma, as you can see, the spin states, and also over the vector k, the wave vector k. And this HC term is written like this, that it is epsilon depending upon the sigma and k vector. And then you have got two operators here, the C dagger operator. So this operator, this dagger operator, the creation operator is indicating the creation of an electron in the spin state sigma with a wave vector k, and multiplied by this destruction operator C, which indicates that the C operator is destroying a electron with a spin state sigma and wave vector k. So this describes the dispersion of electrons in the conduction C which surrounds the ion. So again, from our basic solid state physics, we know that this ion is surrounded by a huge number of electrons which are free to move, and then we sort of refer to it as mobile electrons or even the sea of conduction electrons. When the ion is embedded within a metal, the energy of the d state is degenerate with band electron states. Okay, so this is a very important thing. I mean, this degeneracy has a very important role to play here in this case. And the term, the final term, the S H mixture is summation over the spin state as usual, sigma n over j. And you see, after the summation sign, within the summation sign, you have the parameter v k vector, and again you have the same creation operator c of electron in the with a spin state sigma and a vector k, and then you have multiplied by a destruction operator d sigma. Okay, so this is basically what is happening is that this is describing, this d sigma is describing the destruction over d electron, plus the Hermitian conjugate is important. So this H mixture actually describes the hybridization that takes place with the conduction electron c, where the, as usual, I mean, like I had already mentioned, that d sigma describes the destruction of a d electron. Moreover, this parameter v vector k is the matrix element of the ionic potential between a plane wave's conduction state and the d orbital. Localized moments are the origin of magnetism in insulators, and in metals, their interaction with the mobile charge carriers drastically changes the nature of the metallic state via a mechanism known as the Kondo effect. In a dilute solid solution of a magnetic ion in a non-magnetic metal crystal, for example, MnNCO, the exchange coupling between the ion and the conduction electrons generate new physics. The conduction electron gas is magnetized in the vicinity of the magnetic ion. In such a situation, it generates an indirect exchange interaction between the magnetic ions. One ion perceives the magnetization induced by the other ion. This interaction of the magnetic ion and the conduction electron gives rise to the Kondo effect. Experimentally, the Kondo effect is seen as a minimum in the electrical resistivity versus temperature curve of dilute magnetic alloys at low temperatures. The occurrence of resistance minimum is closely associated with the existence of local magnetic moments. So we have started with the discussion on the Kondo effect, though of course, you know, like this is a very big topic discussion. So let me, you know, briefly again sort of mention that how exactly we think that this is important, the Kondo effect, what is the importance of this and what role has it played. So as we have discussed, the existence of localized moments in dilute alloys that couple to the conduction electron has important consequences for the electrical conductivity. The magnetic impurities act on scattering centers, and if they are the predominant type of impurity or lattice imperfections, then at low enough temperatures, the scattering they cause will be the primary source of electrical resistance. We also know that, you know, the non-magnetic scatterers lead to a temperature independent term towards which the resistivity monotonically drops with decreasing temperature, which is basically the so-called the residual resistivity. Now in magnetic alloys, however, it has been known since 1930 that instead of dropping monotonically, the resistivity has a rather shallow minimum occurring at very low 10 Kelvin temperature, roughly about 10 Kelvin temperature, that depends weakly on the concentration of magnetic impurities. Now, historically, it was not until, 1963 that this minimum was shown by J. Kondo to arise from some unexpected features of the scattering of conduction electrons that arise only when the scattering center has a magnetic moment. In such a case, the exchange interaction between the conduction electron and the local moment leads to scattering event in which the electron spin is flipped with a compensating change of spin of the local moment. Remember that prior to the Kondo analysis, this scattering was treated only to leading order in perturbation theory and was found not to differ qualitatively from the non-magnetic scattering. Kondo discovered, however, that in all higher order of perturbation theory, the magnetic scattering cross-section is divergent, yielding an infinite resistivity. The divergence depends critically on there being a sharp cutoff in the conduction electron wave function distribution, as there is at t equal to 0. Subsequent analysis by Kondo and others have shown that the thermal rounding of the electron distribution removes the divergence, yielding instead a term in the impurity conduction to the resistivity that increases with decreasing temperature. It is the balancing of this term against the phonon contribution which decreases as the temperature falls that results in the resistance minimum, which is a very key feature of the Kondo effect. So, there will always be a certain quantum mechanical amplitude for this spin to flip between up and down configuration. So, you see that when we say that the spin is flipping between up and down configuration, then we can actually imagine this situation like, you know, that double well potential, if you know that in physics. Then you have particle in a double well, then there is a finite probability to tunnel. So, we can treat the two spins as two state system. So, there is a probability that it can tunnel from one to the other, which basically means that the spin can flip. So, this tunneling rate 1 by tau defines the Kondo temperature Tk. So, the Boltzmann's constant Kb multiplied by the Kondo temperature Tk is equal to h cross divided by tau. The Kondo temperature sets the dividing line between local moment behavior where the spin is free and the low temperature limit where the spin becomes highly correlated with the surrounding electrons. Experimentally, this temperature marks the low temperature limit of the Curie susceptibility. So, students, this figure actually shows the resistivity versus the temperature for gold, which is very slightly doped with iron. So, as you can see from here, because of these iron impurities, the resistance shows a minima at a certain temperature. So, if you are going from left to right, that is, you are increasing the temperature, or even if you are going from the right to left, it goes through a dip, the minima, which typically is a Kondo effect. Heavy fermion systems. The investigation of heavy fermion systems with heavy quasi-particle excitation has developed into a new branch of low temperature physics. Heavy fermion materials are a subset of the intermetallic compounds containing F electron elements. These compounds are distinguished at low helium temperatures by anomalously large electronic specific heat coefficient with correspondingly large Pauli paramagnetic susceptibility. We speak of heavy fermion behavior when a system meets the following conditions. So, about this heavy fermion systems, the low temperature specific heat is given by this equation, that is C is equal to gamma T. So, you see here that this gamma plays a very important role, and this coefficient gamma is of the order of 1 joule per mole per Kelvin square rather than 1 millijoule per mole per Kelvin square as, for example, found for sodium metal. So, sodium metal, remember, is not a heavy fermion system. It has got the value of gamma is comparatively much small. Also, the Pauli susceptibility is also enhanced as the coefficient gamma. So, that means that Pauli susceptibility is also very high as compared to the gamma. So, the Pauli susceptibility is also enhanced as this coefficient gamma. That means that it is as, I mean, is higher than, for example, like in sodium metal. Now, also there is another ratio or factor, that is a Sommerfeld-Nielsen ratio, is of the order of almost unity. And this ratio R is actually defined as pi square multiplied by the square of the Boltzmann's constant multiplied by the Pauli susceptibility divided by 3 divided by the coefficient gamma and divided by this nu square effective. So continuing with these heavy fermion systems, that here this new effective that we had defined for this ratio R is the effective magnetic moment of the quasi-particle. Okay. Remember that, you know, like if we have mentioned about this quasi-particle earlier in some slides also, in some modules. So both the quantities gamma and the Pauli susceptibility are proportional to the quasi-particle density of states at the Fermi level, which is proportional to the effective mass m star of the excitations. So these excitations basically are nothing but these quasi-particles. Large values of gamma and the Pauli susceptibility can therefore be attributed to large effective mass m star of the excitations. These excitations basically are becoming heavy. When the above conditions are met, we may assume a one-to-one correspondence between the quasi-particle excitations of the complex system and those of a free electron gas, provided we use the effective mass instead of the bare mass. Okay, so heavy fermion behavior requires the presence of a low energy scale in the system, which is usually characterized by a temperature T star. As the temperature of the system increases to a value greater than T star, the quasi particles lose their heavy mass character. So, students, let us see what we have learned in this module. Local magnetic moments are responsible for strong electron correlations. Local magnetic moments are maximum in rare earth elements. In a dilute solid solution of magnetic ion in a non-magnetic metal crystal, the interaction of the magnetic ion and the conduction electron gives rise to the Kondo effect. Heavy fermion materials are distinguished at low helium temperatures by an enormously large electronic specific heat coefficient with correspondingly large Pauli paramagnetic susceptibility. Thank you.